In this video, I'll be taking a closer look at Windows, and I'll be trying to show off some of the productivity software that I home use and I've run on it. I'll be using the computer I built in a previous video. But first, let's have a tour of Windows and check out what came with it. First is Write. Write is a very basic word processor. No spell check, no automatic figure numbering, clunky controls for changing fonts. It gets the job done, but not more. Then there's Paintbrush, a simple drawing program. Here, I'm copying a picture from Paintbrush to Write. This version of Paintbrush supports Microsoft bitmap files and PCX. I'll show Terminal in a later video. Notepad is a basic text editor, suitable for editing configuration files and other plain text files. New with Windows 3.1 are Ctrl-C and Ctrl-V hotkeys for copy and paste. Recorder allows you to create macros. As a simple demonstration, here I'm creating a short macro that makes 5 copies of the selected text with a number in front. This is then bound to a hotkey, allowing the macro to be triggered. Card file can be easiest seen as a simple database. It's a digital imagination of index cards. It allows for inclusion of text or pictures, but not really at the same time. You could also embed other objects supported by your system, such as voice recordings. There is also a basic search feature, allowing you to quickly find a card you're looking for. Calendar is a very basic calendar. You can print your calendar out and set reminders, but that's about it. Calculator. Yeah, it's a calculator. It has the basics for scientific calculations, as well as support for hex, octal, and binary bases. I guess I don't need my slide rule anymore. Clock. Both digital and analog presentation. It does have a mode for hiding the title bar, while still allowing you to drag it around, so that you can keep it open to the side. Object Packager. This one had me scratching my head for a while. I have no idea why this one's in the Program Manager. The key to understanding Packager is to not open Packager. Instead, let's open some other program. One that is OLE aware. What is OLE? Object Linking and Embedding, a technology for embedding objects from other programs. The idea is that a word processor wouldn't have to know how to draw pictures, for example. To summon the packager, I insert an object of type package. Packager allows us to then embed an arbitrary file inside a document. Here, I'm attaching an MS-DOS executable, pkzip.exe, to my write document. Character Map allows you to study all 256 characters in various fonts installed. This is especially useful if you're trying to insert a specific character from a symbol font. As single byte character encodings were still the norm in the West at this point, special symbols were usually handled by special symbol fonts. Hence, fonts like Windings. Media Player. We've already seen it in a previous video. It's a basic playback program for recorded sounds and MIDI files. Interesting to note is how it makes a distinction on the media based on what drivers use to play it back. Sound Recorder allows you to record sound from your microphone and play it back. It does have some basic adjustments for speed, volume, and the addition of echo. Maximum recording length is 60 seconds, but the limit could be lower if you're low on RAM.
If you think the audio is bad in my videos, you should know it could always be worse.
If you think the audio is bad in my videos, you should know it could always be worse.
Games-wise, Windows comes with Solitaire, a card game that would define wasting time at the computer for the rest of the 90s. There's also Minesweeper, which I'm not very good at. In the main group, File Manager is first up. Here, I'm setting up a few directories. This is what the Format Disk dialog looks like. Next is the Control Panel. First up is Color, where the user interface colors can be tweaked. Very important. Or maybe not. Fonts. Aside from allowing previewing of fonts, you can also add and remove them from the system here. Even the ones installed with the system can be removed. The bitmap fonts, in contrast to TrueType fonts, will preview with all installed sizes. Ports allows for serial ports to be set up. This first dialog are just the default communication parameters for baud rate and such. In advanced, the hardware resources used by each port can be set. Mouse allows for the speed and double click time to be tweaked. There's also that weird checkbox for swapping the mouse buttons. I've never seen anyone use that option. Next is the big one, desktop. First is pattern. I'll just quickly cycle through all of the patterns here. 50% gray, boxes, critters, diamonds, paisley, pattern, quilt, scotty, spinner, thatches, tulip, waffle, weave. There's an option for disabling L-tab window switching. Apparently called cool switch internally. Huh. Then there's a selection of screensavers. Flying windows. Marquee. Mystify, Starfield Simulation. Wallpaper. There's a bunch to choose from. Again, I'll just cycle through all of them. 256 color, arcade, arches, argyle, cars, castle, chits, Egypt, flock, honey, leaves, marble, red brick, rivets, squares, tartan, thatch, wind logo, zigzag. Personally, I've always liked leaves. And that's pretty much everything interesting to choose from here. Keyboard just lets you configure key repeat speed and delay. I'll skip printers for now. International allows you to set locale and keyboard layouts. This is handy since I use the English version of Windows, despite being Swedish. Date and time lets you set date and time. MIDI mapper has some basic settings about which MIDI synth to use and how it's configured. 386 enhanced. Various protected mode settings. Device contention settings relate to multiple programs trying to use the same COM port. Scheduling allows you to tweak how Windows and DOS programs are prioritized. Each DOS program runs on its own virtual machine, and the virtual machines are scheduled preemptively. All Windows programs run in one virtual machine, and the Windows programs are scheduled cooperatively. To keep the system responsive while running MS-DOS and Windows programs at the same time, the Windows virtual machine is handled specially. Virtual memory configures the size of the page file. With virtual memory, RAM is expanded with disk space. By allowing contents of RAM to be temporarily written to disk, Windows can pretend that the system has more RAM than it really does. The driver section of Windows is pretty much all about sound drives and multimedia components. Sound configures various system event sounds. We'll look at Print Manager later. Clipboard Viewer allows you to not only inspect the clipboard, it also allows you to save its content and restore it later. By pressing the print screen key, I've captured a screenshot of my desktop. You can save that from the Clipboard Manager. I can also paste it into Paintbrush to save the screenshot as an actual picture file. MS-DOS Prompt allows you to access MS-DOS without leaving Windows. It can run both in full screen and in a window. You've seen Windows setup when I installed the video drivers in the previous video. Pip Editor creates launch shortcuts for MS-DOS applications. It allows configuration of the memory environment, as well as hints to the task scheduler. README contains a bunch of troubleshooting information and other gotchas. But I think that'll do for the tour. When I built this computer, you might have noticed I left out a peripheral, perhaps the most important part of the computer. That's right, printer. What use is it to do your work on a computer if you can't get it out of your computer? At the time, there were several technologies to choose from. 9-pin dot matrix printer at the bottom of the low end, followed by 24-pin dot matrix models, followed by inkjets in the mid-range, and laser printers at a very high end. The printer I got is a Commodore MPS 1230. It's a 9-pin dot matrix or impact printer capable of printing in monochrome on A4 paper. A dot matrix printer or impact printer works by shoving a bunch of pins against an ink-soaked ribbon towards the paper. Due to it being a mechanical force pushing the ink on the paper, it's also possible to do carbon copies by having pressure-sensitive paper behind the paper you're printing on. Quite a low-end model, especially since the document feeder of mine appears to have buggered off somewhere. In 1992, this model would have been a couple years old. It's the kind of printer you might have originally gotten for something like an Amiga 500, but it is PC compatible. So I'm starting out by installing my printer. In the manual, it's stated that it's emulating an Epson FX85. Therefore, in Windows, I'm using the FX85 driver included with Windows. Except I misread the manual. It's actually emulating an FX80. Oh well. So, to test the printer out, I open up the README file for Windows and Write. Write gives us a first taste of one of Windows 3.1's killer features. Scalable fonts with TrueType. The fonts we see on the screen are roughly what's going to be printed. As you can see now, I'm printing it. Here I also notice something weird with my setup. There's a bunch of noise coming out of my speakers as I print. My sound card has Kovac speech pin compatibility, which is a parallel port attached sound card. It's supposed to be on a different parallel port, but apparently not. Anyway, most people will get something more capable. There was a variety of productivity software that you could pirate from work, like Microsoft Office. In 1992, it was estimated that up to 30% of all software was legally acquired. If you didn't do any of that, and you didn't run a high-value business at home, you'd probably be stuck with Microsoft Works, an oxymoron if I've ever heard one. It was a low-cost option often bundled with Microsoft Publisher and Microsoft Money as the Microsoft Solution Series. A lot of low-end computers were bundled with it back in the day. It was not just a low-end solution in price and features. It also used less disk space on the hard disk, which means a lot less floppies for me to swap. So I'll be installing Microsoft Works 2.0 next. Aside from containing a slightly more capable word processor, it includes spreadsheets and a database. I'm not going to look too closely at the database functionality, as these days we've long since ditched those on the client side. Today, we use hugely unwieldy spreadsheets instead. Infinite tables, am I right? Oh, and don't forget the clipart. Cliparts have the value. Here, I'm putting together a quick document, not forgetting the clipart. Worth noting is that there is no automatic functions for numbering tables or figures. No automatic table of contents. Not really much automatic of anything. You don't define headings or such, you just manually change the font size. Unlike Microsoft Write, Microsoft Works also includes spell checking and a thesaurus. Next, I'm jumping into the spreadsheet part. My goal here is to put in a few basic numbers and make a plot, which I'll then import into my document. By accident, I discovered a notation for time of day that is used with my current locale settings. This has the interesting side effect that Works creates a plot in which one axis is aware of time. This is a feat I've never managed in Excel for as long as I've been working a real job. As I'm saving the document, you may notice that none of the formats seem at all universal and compatible. Back then, if you wanted to be sure that the receiver could read the document properly, you just fax it. You might imagine it's quite difficult to create documents with any kind of fancy layout. For this reason, Microsoft Works was often bundled with Microsoft Publisher. Publisher starts up with an introduction, letting you know about objects and the tools for creating them. One big feature of Publisher is the Page Wizard. It allows you to create a number of different documents, like calendars, greeting cards, and newsletters. All you need to do is answer a few simple questions, and it sets up the structure for you. Once you hit Create, you get to watch it create the document, one object at a time. Or you can speed it up as fast as it'll go. As a result of this guide, I now have a basic calendar for the month of December. Anyway, let's have a quick look at the newsletter wizard before I try creating something from scratch. More of the same, just slightly more interesting layouts. This would definitely be difficult to create in Works. Anyway, I think I've seen enough to create something on my own. I'm just going for something simple, with a bit of clip art. What I'm doing right now I probably couldn't have done in Works, but I'm curious. How does Publisher deal with text wrapping around pictures? Well, turns out, it does deal with it, but in the least visually pleasing way possible. Out of curiosity, I also added a clip art picture from Microsoft Works, and placed it in the middle of some text. Let's print this. Out of curiosity, I also wanted to print it on a modern laser just for comparison. Publisher doesn't export to any formats that I can use for that though. Using the built-in Windows PostScript printer driver, with it set to output to a file, I'm able to get a high quality output that I can open on a modern computer. Except the font is kind of boogered up. And lastly, I almost forgot to show you something cool, back in MS-DOS. You know that print screen key? You know what its original purpose was, before it made screenshots in Windows? To print the screen! If you look closely, you'll see that the backslashes on the printout aren't actually backslashes. This is a character encoding mismatch. I'm not going to go into the details now, but if you ever wondered why there's 6 symbol characters allowed in nicknames on IRC, there is a connection to this.
But I think that'll do for this video. Check back next week, when I'll be going online like it's 1992. And as always, thank you for watching.